people like to think of as forgotten, who were lost in Chicago, in a city. And one of those, me and my brother, we actually went to a sugar bush camp in Gun Lake a while ago, again with Sean. And we were able to learn, a process of how that sadness collected, cooked down, and a lot of the teachings that come along with that process. And one of those, something as like indigenous people that we have to do is we have to address everything, the weather. We have to think of everything. We're not apart from the ecosystem, we're a part of it. And so part of that is with the maple tap, we need to see how much moisture is in the area throughout the year. If the trees are healthy, how old the trees are, what kind of ecosystem these trees are in. And in Chicago, the trees are under a lot of stress. So a lot of the times when there's infrastructure work, sewage, electrical, they dig down and they're tearing into these tree roots. And so for two years, my family went outside and we tapped their trees on our block. We were collecting sap, just enough for ourselves, enough to give. And we were doing that for a number of years, and winter came and it was unnecessary. It was unusually warm, and so there was no snow that covered the ground in Chicago that year. And it was like that for 2 years, where there was no snow on the ground. We couldn't take from those trees that year, because if we were, it would have been disrespectful, and it would have ultimately harmed the tree itself. And so within those 2 years of us not tapping, there was some infrastructure work that had happened, and it killed three of the maple trees that were on the block. And they're not sugar maples, they're not the traditional trees that we harvest there, box elder, or Norwegian maples, silver maples, that aren't seen as invasive in Chicago, but since the sugar maples have more of a tap root, they're seen as invasive to the infrastructure. So a lot of the maple trees were cut down in Chicago, in Illinois. And so that's just one of the ways that we're putting ourselves in that ecosystem, putting ourselves back into the natural world.
Away from Whiteyear, Minnesota, and northern Cheyenne from Lake Montana. Lindsay Bushell, Muscle Civic First Nations Cree and Chicago Lakota, as well as Mark. And I'm the co-president of the Chinese Nations Youth Council. And so one thing Winfield and Adrian mentioned was this plot of land that we found. And you guys watched our land acknowledgement video. And so the land acknowledgement was something that our youth council, you know, we wrote together, we wrote collectively. It was like the very first piece of legislation that our youth council kind of drafted and submitted to our alderman to have him submit it for us. And so we thought it was very important when we did the land acknowledgement to acknowledge those waterways, like Winfield said, to acknowledge Lake Michigan, to acknowledge the Chicago River, to acknowledge the Mississippi, to acknowledge that Chicago was and is still a site of trade and travel, you know, for our people. There's over 65,000 American Indians that live within Chicago, within our boundaries. And so, you know, with that many Native people living in our cities, why don't we have representation on a city level? Why don't we have representation on a state level? Why don't we have representation on a federal level? Why don't we have any elected officials who are Native in our state? And so, for us to be able to write this resolution and give it to one of our elected officials who had submitted it as is was very powerful, because to have Indigenous people and Indigenous youth to be able to tell our own story in their language, in the white man's language, was very powerful to us, because oftentimes people are speaking for us and not with us. Not with us present. And so when we did that, we came at it with like this Indigenous lens, and acknowledging the past, but very much still acknowledging like the future. Because a lot of times when our people are talked about, they're put in the past tense, and we're never talked about in the present tense. And so that's important for us. And so with that, it was kind of like the opening of the First Nations Garden. And you've seen in the video, and you heard them talking, we kind of erected teepees there just so to show the neighborhood that Native people still live here, and that Native people are very much a part of the Albany Park community where the garden was located. And it started generating a lot of questions in our neighborhood. The alderman got a lot of calls, as well as the city, and it got all of this attention. And although that is, it can be very emotionally draining on our youth council, it was something that was very much needed, because now everyone in our area and everyone in Chicago knows that there has been and there still is a very strong Indigenous presence. With that came that resolution and this plot of land. But we also, we wanted to continue doing that writing. And so we wrote an ordinance which would change our municipal code to change Columbus Day into Indigenous Peoples Day. And so it would abolish Columbus Day in the city. And what a lot of people don't know is, so here in the state of Illinois, they passed a kind of like a resolution acknowledging giving Indigenous Peoples Day a day in September, making it its own separate day, rather so they can abolish Columbus Day. But Chicago, since this is a large city, we have home rule authority, so being able to just ditch Columbus Day, abolish it, and acknowledge the people who were directly impacted by Columbus, Puerto Rico, Cuba, but acknowledge those islanders down there and acknowledge the struggles that they had to go through. It is something that we thought was very important to give people who don't have a voice that voice.
Hello everybody, my name is Asia Curley, and I am Ojibwe from Wisconsin, and be around poor people, and we had a we had a